couple of things to announce. One is this coming Saturday is church work day. We thought we were going to do it yesterday. It was supposed to rain on Saturday. We watched the weather for a couple days there, and they were saying, it's going to rain Saturday, all day. It's going to rain. It's going to start early in the morning. It's going to go all day. It's going to rain all day Saturday. It's going to be bad. Well, I didn't watch the weather Friday, and obviously somewhere between Wednesday evening and Friday, they said, it's not going to rain until Saturday evening. And so, anyways, we called work day off, but guess what? We actually put the work day out a few weeks ahead of Easter, so if it rained, if we had some kind of disruption, we can still do it. So this Saturday, 8 o'clock, be here or be square, right? 8 o'clock Saturday, come. We're going to just do some work on the outside of the building, may do a few things in here. If you are unsure if you can help, believe me, you can help. So come. We'll have something for you to do. Amen. We're ready to get started this morning. Today, I want to tell you, before Brother Randall comes and we pray, today is Youth Sunday. Amen? Let's give a great hand clap this morning for Youth Sunday. So, amen. We're excited. We're excited for Youth Sunday. We're excited that you're here this morning. We're ready to go to the Lord in prayer. Brother Randall, will you come this morning?
Good morning. We just want to make you feel welcome this morning. We're glad that you are here. If you are visiting with us, certainly glad to have you. Hope that you will continue to join with us. We're just glad that God has been gracious this morning and that He has delivered each and every one of you here this morning. He's directed your path. Before we open with prayer, I do want to share a list of needs with you this morning. Remember Roy Luckadoo, he has an unspoken request. Remember Gia Luckadoo this morning, she is having an angiogram on Friday the 5th. Let's pray about that this morning. Let's remember Harry Skipper. Most of you know that he fell from a ladder this weekend. He has broken ribs and a collarbone. He's in the hospital. He's in Vanderbilt. So let's just pray for Harry this morning. Let's remember Ron Foy. We prayed for him the last couple of weeks. Due to complications, they were waiting to do surgery on him. However, they have done the surgery. It went well, and he is recovering. So we want to give God praise for that this morning. Let's remember Coy. He has broken out in a rash. And let's remember Eugene Bagley this morning. He is suffering from heart issues. If you have needs of your own, just raise your hands this morning. Thank you for that. If you're able to stand with us, let's just go to Him in prayer this morning. Let's just offer our thanks to Him, and let's just invite Him in this morning because we need Him in our midst. Amen? Just pray with us this morning. Gracious Heavenly Father, God, we stand in awe this morning of who You are, God, and what You do, what You're capable of doing. Father, we just thank You for Your love. God, for Your ability to provide for our needs, Your willingness. Father, we thank You for Your grace and Your mercy this morning. We thank You for Jesus Christ. Father, we praise You for Your ability and Your desire to heal. And we thank You that You hear our prayers this morning because we belong to You. Father, this morning we ask that You would do that which we cannot do for ourselves. Father, we ask this morning that You would do that which doctors cannot do. Father, healing comes from You and You alone. Father, this morning we ask that You would receive our burden. God, we ask that You would touch Roy Luckadoo this morning. Father, he has an unspoken request. Father, You know what this request is. You know what Roy needs. And Father, we just ask that You would touch him this morning, God, that You would grant those things that he needs. Father, continue to gift Roy and continue to get to use him, Father, and just continue to touch him. Father, for Gia this morning, Father, she's having an angiogram on Friday. Father, we want to pray ahead of this test. Father, we're asking that once again you would touch her, God, that you'd be merciful. Father, that you would touch her body this morning, God, that you would allow the results that she so desperately desires, Father, that you would just touch her and that you'd just minister healing to her, God. Father, that you'd just touch her mind this morning, God, that you'd put her at ease. And Father, whatever she has need of this morning, God, would you just touch Gia and just continue to bless her, Father. God, we thank you for Brother Harry this morning. God, we thank you that your hand has been upon him for so many years. God, through so many times, Father, you've reached out to him. God, we're asking once again that you touch Harry as we continue to pray for him. Father, that you touch the broken ribs, that you touch the collarbone. Father, I know that he had blood in his lungs. Father, would you touch that this morning, God? Whatever he's in need of, Father, would you touch and just administer your healing power? Father, we thank you, God, for what you do through him. And Father, how you use Harry. And Father, what he means to this church and what he means as a husband and a father and his grandfather. God, we're just asking that you would be with him this morning, that you would allow him to feel your presence even now. Father, that you would allow him to return home. God, that you would give him quick recovery. Father, I just feel compelled this morning, if he has any other needs, any other issues in his life and in his body, God, that this morning that you would touch him, Father, and that you would give him complete healing. Father, touch Diane this morning. God, we thank you for Ron Foy. We thank you for what you've done for him. God, we just pray for your continued blessing upon him. God, that you would lift his spirits. And Father, whatever he needs physically, whatever healing, God, we thank you for the surgery that it went so well. God, we thank you for your ways this morning. We just pray for your continued blessing upon him, that you would just continue to touch him. God, that you would draw him unto yourself. Father, for Coy this morning, we pray, God, that you would touch him, that this rash, Father, that you would allow it just to disappear this morning. Just, Father, in your own way, touch him, God, and just allow healing in his body. Father, just take this rash. And, Father, whatever he needs, just be with him this morning, God, and just allow your mercy and your grace just to fill his little body. Father, for Eugene Bagley, the heart issues, God, we pray this morning that, Father, what time has stolen, God, the ravages of time and the physical ailments that accustom company this life, God, we just pray that you would turn those back this morning for Eugene Bagley. God, that you would touch his heart. Father, that you just hold it in your hands this morning. Father, that you would reconstruct and that you would bless and that you would renew and that you would refresh. Father, that you would just touch him this morning, that you would heal him, God. Allow him to feel your strength this morning. Father, we praise you, God, once again for what you do for us. Father, we depend upon you that you're never changing, God, that you are good to your word. And Father, what you said thousands of years ago, what you inspired, Father, you're good for that today. Father, that your word never changes. It's not something that every 2 or 3 years that we reprint because the changes have been made. Oh no, it's something that we can stand on for our entire life, for the entirety of mankind. We stand upon your word and who you are. And Father, we ask this morning that you would speak to us. Father, that you would forgive us, God, for anything that we've done against you, for the things that perhaps are in our lives that shouldn't be. God, help us with those things. Father, forgive us this morning. God, allow your presence to fill this place. God, we just hunger for you this morning. We ask that you would have your way. God, just fill this place and touch your people. Thank you, Father. God, we praise you. We ask these things in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Good morning. Thank you, Brother Randall, for opening up in prayer, just set the atmosphere. Just want to say welcome to everyone here this morning, and I think you're in the right place. Pastor usually says that you're in the right place if you're here this morning to worship. You know, God, after 6 days of creation, he rested on the seventh day and just rejoiced in what he's done, and he invites us to do that, to come together on this seventh day and just worship and rejoice. And today is the day that the Lord has made. Let's sing this song together. Today is the day.
I will rejoice and be glad in it. Today is the day.
Amen. Can we lift him up this morning? We worship you, Jesus. We thank you and praise you for who you are. We thank you, Jesus. Today is the day that you have made, and I worship you today. Amen. Amen. What a mighty God we serve. He is able to get us to where we need to be. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. I have a couple more announcements that I have to make. I took pictures of the bulletin. I couldn't read some of this, but I have enlarged it. Lilies, if you want to donate a lily, an Easter lily, they're $10 a piece. And those need to be turned in by April 14th, next week. It'll be in next week's bulletin. We have a little form that you can fill out. So just to kind of put that on your mind, just so you'll be thinking about that. I've had some guys ask me about Men on the Mountain. And the Men on the Mountain, the registration has to be in, the early bird has to be in by April 25th. We remember there's a limit of how many people can go to this. So we want to go ahead and get our stuff in for Men on the Mountain. It's $45. You just turn that into the church. There's a sign-up sheet outside. You can just take a tithing envelope and just put the $45 in that, check, cash, whatever you want to do. If you want to put your debit card in there and just say, we will figure out a way to get that out of there. No. And just mark on the tithing envelope, Men on the Mountain. Write your name on there. Don't put the money in there and not put your name in on you, because we need to know who it goes to, and we'll get that taken care of. So, amen. We're excited about that. We're ready to do youth camp registration is in 2 weeks. The deadline for the early bird, and some of you parents who have done this thing, early bird deadline is really important for youth camp. It cuts your cost. Yeah, something like that. And it is April 19th. We have to have those applications and the deposit in for youth camp applications. So if you have any questions on youth camp, it starts at first grade and it goes through 12th. So if you have any questions on youth camp, if you want to be a worker or anything like that, it's good. I love youth camp. It's a great...
Spirit of the living God, we are. world into creation, God. And every word you have, God, is food for our soul, God. It's life. It's life, God. Thank you. Thank you for your amazing grace, your mercy, your grace, God, is new every morning, God. Praise your name. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I found. I was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to be, and grace my fears relieved. How precious. Done for us, God. You set us free, Lord God. Lord, in this freedom, God, we have the freedom to worship, freedom to praise your name, Lord God. And when we worship him, when we praise his name, oh, we're fighting battles beyond what you can ever imagine. When the enemy tries to come against you, you just do this. Just give him praise. praise, just even worship. This is the way we fight our battles this year.
Amen. Let's do that right now. Let's fight some battles. Oh, Father, we worship you this morning. We worship you this morning. We come this morning and we lift you up. We praise you and honor you. Can we do that right? Can we just lift up the name of Jesus, the only name that can bring you salvation? Jesus, I come to you today and I exalt your name. Today, I declare that I need you. God, I cannot live this life without you. It's too broken, it's too empty, it's too troublesome. But today, freedom is in the house, and today I worship you. Today I praise you. Today I honor you. Today I love you. I want to know the Savior of the world. God, I worship your mighty name this day. We praise you and honor you. We worship the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Praise his name. Praise his name. Amen. You may be seated. Turn with me to the book of John this morning. Continuing just a few days before the crucifixion. Just a few days before the tomb. And we peek into the life of Jesus. We see what's going on in the life of Jesus. I want to say real quick one name that we should have put on the prayer list, and Ann Moore. Some of you may know Ann Moore. Sometimes Ann sits kind of back in front of the sound booth back there, and Todd. Ann went last week to a funeral. A relative had passed away, an uncle had passed away in Florida down near Fort Lauderdale, and they took Ann to the hospital. Thought she'd had a heart attack. She's got congestive heart failure. Her heart is working at about 25%. Ann needs prayers. Ann needs God's touch. She is in a position physically that without God's help, she is not going to do very good without God. So we need to be praying for her. Let's look this morning at the book of John, 12th chapter. We're going to go to the 12th verse, John 12:12. We're going to talk just for a few minutes. Last week we talked about Mary anointing Jesus' feet, wiping his feet with her hair, and that worshipful scene that took place. What a glorious time that is. This is John 12, verse 12, talks about the triumphal entry. This is when Jesus gets on the donkey's colt, and he rides into Jerusalem. He comes off the Mount of Olives, and he rides into Jerusalem. And the people, thousands of people show up, and all these people show up, and they all worship God, and they're all praising God, and they bring the palm branches, and they lay them down, and people are shouting and glorifying God. So I want us to look at that this morning. We're going to talk about some of this, and we're going to just lift up the name of Jesus. Amen. Let's look at John 12, verse 12. And it says this: the next day a great multitude that had come to the feast, when they had heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. So all these people, they were coming to the feast. And then when they heard about Jesus coming, they came in to meet him. And then verse 13 says, they took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him. And they cried out, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel." They call him the King of Israel. They say, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." They exalt his name, but then they say of him that he is the King of Israel. Verse 14 says, then Jesus, when he found a young donkey, he sat on it, and as it is written, "Fear not, daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt." Zechariah 9:9 testifies to Jesus being the king. He testifies, that Old Testament scripture testifies to Jesus being the king. It goes on in verse 16, it says, his disciples did not understand these things at first. Have you ever been there before? Have you ever been to the place where you saw stuff going on and you scratched your head a little bit and you said, what is going on? What is all this going on? One day down at the square, they were having some kind of big car show down there thing, and I came through town and I was trying to cut through on one of those little roads, and they had that road blocked off, and I said, what in the world is going on? They got my road blocked off. Who has done this? And then I looked, and there was tents and cars and stuff everywhere, and after a few minutes, I said, oh, somebody else is using this road. So this is what happens here. The disciples, they did not understand these things at first, the Bible says, but when Jesus was glorified, amen, when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that these things were written about him, and that they had done these things to him. Verse 17 says, therefore the people who were there with him when he called, Lazarus out of the tomb and raised him from the dead, bore witness. They talked about the great event of Lazarus being raised from the dead. And not just that Lazarus was raised from the dead, but they talked about it, that it was Jesus was the one who did it. Let's go. Let's look here at Zechariah 9:9. I want to read this passage out of the Old Testament. We're gonna look at this first. This is kind of what this passage is kind of standing on is this Old Testament passage in Zechariah 9:9. It says this: "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and having salvation, lowly and riding on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey." Now I want us to look at this here for a minute, because here in Zechariah 9:9, you can leave that up for a minute. Here in Zechariah 9:9, he says, what I need you to do, he says, I need you to rejoice greatly. I need you to rejoice greatly. I don't know if any of you have watched any of the basketball tournament that the March Madness NCAA basketball tournament that's been on. It's always interesting because at the end of the game, because these games, you lose one game, you're out of the tournament. And at every game, at the end, one team is over there going, "Wow, we won, we won." And the other team is going, "Oh, we're going home, we're going home." Well, this past week, Tennessee was one of those teams over there crying, "We're going home, we're going home." But one of the things that happens is they rejoice greatly. I've never seen a team win, especially when you get to like the Sweet 16, you get to the Final Four. I've never seen a team win one of these games and go, "I think we won. Isn't that great? I'm going to stop by Sonic and get a hamburger on the way home." No. These guys are rejoicing greatly. Why? Because something amazing has happened. When something amazing happens, we generally don't do an Eeyore. Everybody know about Eeyore, right? When something happened to Eeyore, I mean, the greatest thing in the world, Eeyore would say, "Oh, well, it looks like great things have happened." And everybody else, Tigger's jumping, everybody's going crazy. No, here in Zechariah 9:9, this is what the Bible says. You need to rejoice greatly. We just did that. We sang songs about Jesus, about him being the Savior, about him being our deliverer. We need to rejoice greatly. There is a reason why the Bible tells us to rejoice greatly. It's because something amazing has happened. The King has come. The deliverance has come. The grip of death, hell, and the grave has been broken. So he tells us, he says, behold. He says, rejoice greatly. And then as we read down, we see the word behold. We see the word behold. What does that mean? What does he mean when he says, "O daughter of Jerusalem, behold, your king is coming to you"? Behold, that means to stop and pay attention. I need you to pay attention. I need you to put everything down. This is what I tell my kids: put all electronics down. If you give my kids a tablet or a phone, guess what? You have lost them. They are in three dimensions away from me. They're in another world. They're in a galaxy far, far away. They are beyond Luke Skywalker and Han Solo. They are beyond R2-D2. They are gone. They are playing something, and I cannot retrieve them. Sometimes I'll say, "Hey, guys, I need you to come to supper." And guess what they do? They're walking through the house with a tablet. And I pull that tablet out of their hand, and I say, no, I'm not finished with that game. I'm almost to the elite level. Right now, we're going to have family time. We're going to look at each other in the face, and we're going to talk English words to each other. We're going to speak words to each other, and we're going to communicate like humans. So this word here says, behold. It means to stop and to pay attention. Let me tell you just a little quick story about stop and pay attention. Several years ago, I was probably about 8, 10 years old. Me and my dad, my brother, and a neighborhood kid, we had went out, and we were, we were rabbit hunting, I guess. We were out, but my dad was the only one with a gun. And my dad had a gun, and we were walking through this little patch of woods. It's kind of half woods, half weeds. It's right on the edge of the woods. We're walking through there, and in an instant, there is a snake curled up, probably about a 3-4 foot snake sitting there, curled up, ready to bite one of us. We're walking right at it. We do not see it. And my dad says, "Stop, snake." Boom! And all I see is a piece about this long of a snake go kind of flip through the air. After that, when my dad said, stop, snake, I knew that what I do is I look at the ground because I knew that there's a snake on the ground. In this passage, he says, behold, I need everybody to pay attention to what he said. I need you to focus on this. I need you not to let this moment pass without you understanding that your king is coming to you. I need you to grab a hold that your king is coming to you. That's what Zechariah 9:9 is saying. And here's what he says. The king is just. The king is just. I don't know if anybody understands what justice is. Justice is understanding that what the law says, that we do what the law says. Now, there's a difference between being just and fair. When you're fair, that means if I had $100 and I said that I'm going to, either me or Jerry Fontaine's going to get this $100 or somehow we're going to give out this $100. If I was fair, I would get 50 and Jerry would get 50. We would always divide that up equally. That would be fair. But just says what the law says. We do what the law says. What's written in the law, we obey the law. And so to be just, Jesus always does what's written in the law. He's always going to give a judgment according to the scriptures. So he's just. The Bible says he's just. We need somebody who's just because I believe in the day that we live, not everybody is just. Not everybody. The law will be different from one person to the other. We just saw that in the media. We had a guy in the media just a couple weeks ago, faked a crime. And then the district attorney in Chicago said, well, we just didn't think it was really that bad. He had 19 felonies against him. But we didn't really think it was that bad. So we're going to let him off. He's a multimillionaire anyways, and he's got political help. It doesn't matter. We're going to let him off. I don't know about you, but if you were sitting at Coffee County Jail and you had 19 felonies on you, and you're getting ready to go, and the district attorney's getting ready to prosecute you, and you called the sheriff, say you knew the sheriff or you knew the judge in town, you called the sheriff and said, hey, I need help. He's a just man. You know what he says? According to the law is how you will be treated. That's how you will be treated according to the law. If you did the crime, you have to do the time. And so it's beyond my control here, but what he says is Jesus is just. He's just. You know what? That's the king that I want. I don't want politicians who say, my friends go free. The working man pays. I don't want that. I want to say, if somebody gets in trouble, we all follow the law. Here's what he says. Not only that, but he says that he is empowered with salvation. He's empowered with salvation. What does that mean? That means that when an opportunity comes up, that when somebody is stuck, that Jesus can always get them out. That he can save that which is lost. He is empowered with salvation. He can always save that which is lost. Now, it's interesting because there's always times in our lives where we get into situations where we cannot save what's lost, right? We can't do it. Just about 2 years ago, I was out in my field. It had rained. The field was wet. I was out there. I was on one side of the fence. My dog was on the other side of the fence. The fence is electric. The bottom wire is hot. The dog comes over there. She's standing in muddy, soaky field. It's wet, soaking wet. I don't know if you understand electricity, but it helps the current to travel if you're grounded. If you're standing in water, you're better grounded. The dog walks over there. She touches the fence with her nose and gives a great yeah. Because that charger said, you are not to cross this fence. And the dog turned and ran away. And she wouldn't talk to me for days. And I felt so bad for her. But you know what? I could not save that dog. I saw her coming to the fence. I saw her when she was about 6 inches away. Her nose was, and I could not save her. And I wanted to save her. And I said, Piper, no, don't touch. Piper, no, no, no. Oh, and the dog was like, oh, are you calling me to you? Do you want me to come to you? And the dog touches the fence with the nose. And when she does, I'm telling you, that dog yelled and she turned and she ran and she had her tail between her legs and she was hurting and it bothered me. Why? Because I could not save her. I am not the dog's savior. Zechariah 9:9 says Jesus is empowered with salvation. He's empowered. He can save that which is lost. That's what I'm excited about Jesus. Here's what he says. He says that he's humble. He's humble. Isn't that great? How many do you know that when somebody gets in power, they say, I'm in power. I run this place now. I own this place. You better listen to me. No, Jesus said, hey, come in, sit down. Let's talk. He's humble. He's empowered with salvation, but he's humble. But here in the end of this passage here, it says that your king will come seated on a colt, the foal of a donkey. Now that's interesting because that doesn't say a whole lot about kingship and different things like that. I mean, there are some things in there. But the interesting thing is it testifies in this story in John chapter 12 because when he rides in, he comes. The testimony is true because he is on the donkey. He is riding on the donkey. So we see that the testimony is true. Zechariah 9:9, this passage is referred to in John 12. And then we go on down in John 12 and we see again, last week we talked about this, but Lazarus, they talk about Lazarus again. Man, this guy Lazarus is getting all kinds of TV time. He's always on the screen. Every time we look at this, Lazarus is being talked about. And what it says is that they're still testifying about the miracle of Lazarus. They're still testifying. They're talking about Lazarus. The people who came to worship Jesus that day, the people who came to celebrate Jesus, one of the things that was being talked about was Lazarus. That's what's being talked about. Who is Jesus? He's the man who raised Lazarus from the dead. That's who he is. Surely somewhere in your life there's something that you've done, whether it be good or bad, that people say, who is that? And they say, that's the kid, don't you remember, in the neighborhood who jumped that bike and broke his arm? Oh, yeah, the boy broke his arm. My brother jumped a motorcycle one time about 25, 30 feet, and when he landed on the handlebars and broke his collarbone. And so then he became known. They'd say, who is that? That's the guy who broke his collarbone that day on the motorcycle. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, the guy that walked around going, oh, yeah. Yeah, that's him. What did they say about Jesus? They said, he is the one who raised Lazarus from the dead. Why is that so important? It's important because when things die, we can't bring them back. I've buried a few dogs in my days, buried a few horses. Couple of cats. My neighbor one day asked me, why do you want to fence your dog in? I got an underground fence. I said, because I don't want to pick it up off the highway. It's too hard to go through that. I cannot bring that dog back. When Rebel gets hit, when Fluffy gets hit, that's it. But here's the interesting thing, is that they're talking about Lazarus. Why? Because Jesus has the authority. The things that are dead, he raises them back to life. Now here's what I want to say about that. We have to understand that when Jesus was in the tomb, when he went on the cross and died, they put him in a tomb. He was in the tomb for 3 days. When he came back, he was not the same when he came back was when he was before. The disciples were like, oh, glory, Jesus is back. We're going to hang out. We're going to go down to Sonic and have an ice cream with Jesus. It's going to be so great. We're going to talk old fishing tales, and we're going to talk hunting stories and all this stuff, because this was all men, right? 12 men? I would think they talked a lot of hunting stories and things. And Eric, like one guy said, I caught a bass one time, and it was this big. And what's somebody else going to say? I caught one that was this big. And then, like, 40 minutes later, one guy's like, I caught one so big, you know, and it like never ends. But here's the thing is, when Jesus came back, it wasn't the same. It wasn't the same. Why? It was actually better. Sometimes when God brings something back, we want it to be exactly the same, don't we? Don't we want it to be exactly the same? But what happens? Sometimes when God heals something, sometimes when God brings something back, sometimes when God restores something, be reminded of this, that it may be different. It may be different. Because when we see this, we think, wow, this is amazing. Here's the thing it is. When Lazarus was there that day, remember now, he's older. The man's still aging. He's going to die one day. It's not like that Lazarus, he's been raised from the dead. It's not like that he's some kind of angel now and he can never die. No, the man's going to die. But we see Lazarus here, and this is what happens. Jesus is known because he heals broken things. And what does every person in Jerusalem that day have in common is they have broken stuff in their life. Every one of them has broken stuff. And they acknowledge Jesus because he heals broken stuff. That's why it's so important that Lazarus is mentioned here. That's why they want to talk about Lazarus. The Bible says that they're continuing to testify. Here they are, they're worshiping Jesus, they're laying down palm branches, people are taking off their coats, they're laying all this stuff on the ground. Jesus is coming through Jerusalem and they're singing, Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed be the King of Israel, Hosanna, Hosanna. They're worshiping him, and then there's also people in the midst of that, they're saying, do you know that he's the one who raised Lazarus from the dead? Do you know that he takes broken things and he brings them back to life? Do you know that he takes old stuff and broken and hurt and destroyed and he raises it up and he heals it? Here's what we've got to do, though, to allow God to raise up broken things. What happened in the story of Lazarus? They had to allow Jesus to do this. What did the disciples say? Don't you care? Lazarus is sick. He's going to die. Don't you care? Don't you care, Jesus? And then somebody came and said, he's dead. He's dead. Lazarus is dead. Don't you care? Don't you care? Somewhere in there, we just have to say, Lazarus, Jesus, we're giving all this to you. Jesus, we're going to give Lazarus to you. Somewhere in there, we have to just hand it to him. And say, it's yours. It's yours. That's the struggle that I have. When something is broken, I don't always want to give it to him. I want to hold on to it while he does it. Anybody there with me? Anybody want to kind of hold on to it? Anybody want to say, God, I'm glad you're here today, and I'm glad that you're helping with this situation, but I'm still the manager here. I'm still running the show, God. I'm glad you're here to help us, and you're going to do this under my direction a little bit. We don't say that, but we think it sometimes, if we want to be honest. But here's what happened in Lazarus' situation. Jesus let him die and be dead for 3 days that everybody would let go of it. They all let go of it. And they were all crying, and everybody was weeping, and they were all sad. And Jesus said, here's what I'm going to do. Is I'm going to heal the broken. But we have to let go of it to let him heal it. We got to give it to him. We got to give the broken stuff to him. We've got to let go and let him have that. I feel the Holy Spirit just telling me, let go of it. Let him have it. And then as we move on down in this scripture, one of the things that I find so interesting, it says that the disciples did not understand everything that was going on until Jesus was glorified. Until they glorified, while the people were glorifying Jesus. I find it interesting that he picks 12 men, and I don't think that he's going to pick the worst 12 that he could find. It wasn't like, you know, this guy over here is like the town drunk or something, and Jesus is like, yeah, I'll take you. No, he picks 12 men. Now, they're not perfect. These guys are not perfect. But I know that he picks them because they can give something to the kingdom of God. And he picks these 12 men, and they were with him for a few years. They had spent their time with Jesus. And they did not get what was going on. Isn't that interesting? Don't you see that? That they're 5 days from the crucifixion. They're 6 days from the crucifixion. And they don't understand what's going on. They don't get it. But when people started to worship, when people started to glorify God, when the Lord's name was lifted up, when the name of Jesus, when they started singing praises to Jesus, somebody in the room said, I get it. I'm starting to see this thing. There's something about when we lift up the name of Jesus. Let's look this morning at Luke chapter 19, verse 40. Luke 19, 40. This is talking about the same story. It's in the book of Luke. It's talking about the same story. 19 verse 40 says, but he answered and said to them, let me just back up and explain this passage real quick. The Pharisees are there, and as Jesus is coming through town, as all this worship is going on, as everything is happening that day, and all the shouts are going on, the Pharisees said, time out. We cannot worship this man Jesus like he is somehow connected to God. We can't do it. And this is what Jesus says to them. But he answered and said to them, I tell you that if these should keep silent, the stones would maybe cry out. No, he said immediately cry out. He said, if these people don't worship me, that the stones that the buildings are made out of, that the stones that the streets are made out of, that the stones that are laying in the ditch, that they are going to worship God. There is a time here. There is an opportunity here to worship God. And it is in this opportunity to worship God that when the praise of Jesus starts to go up, the disciples said, now we understand. Now we're starting to get a hold of what's going on. Jesus is the Son of God, that he is the Messiah, that he is the King of Israel. And they start to worship Jesus, and there is something that starts to move in that day. Something starts to happen. The power of God starts to move in those people, and the people start to see God. There is a difference when God just walking by and Jesus, when we glorify him, that there is a difference. When we glorify him, when we honor him, there is a difference in what happens. And that day, when they worshiped him, see, this is why when we sing the songs, when we come into the house, when we sing the songs, we're not just having a meeting. This is not just Kiwanis Club or the Ruatan Club, you know. That's not what this is. We're not just here that in 2 or 3 weeks we might do a benevolent act somewhere. Now, we're going to do that, but one of the biggest things about us coming into this house is that we lift up the name of Jesus, that we glorify the King of Kings, that we glorify the Messiah, that we worship. When we sing the songs, I'm not just reading them off the screen. Oh, come all ye faithful. No. When I read that, I say, oh, God, I worship you. When I'm reading those songs, when I'm singing those songs, it's more than I'm just singing a song. It's more than I'm just saying words. But I am giving praise to my God. I'm directing my praise to a certain person, the person of Jesus Christ. Amen. That's where my praise is going. It's going to Jesus. Something happens when we praise his name. Something happens when we glorify Jesus. Just a few days before the crucifixion. It's just a few days. And Jesus comes into town. And the first time that it's happened. It's the first time that a public worship service in his name has happened. It's the first time. But it's interesting, when that takes place, he's ready to go to the cross. Isn't it interesting that when Jesus is worshiped, and it seems like that his ministry is so powerful. Matter of fact, on down there in Luke 19, I think it's verse 41, or maybe it's John 12, toward the end of that, and somewhere in there, the Pharisees say, the whole world has turned to him. This thing is so bad. It's really bad because everybody's worshiping him. But I find it interesting that when everybody starts to worship Jesus, he goes to the cross and dies. Now, there's a piece of that that seems kind of odd, but really, if you think about it, there's a piece of it that seems amazing. Because when we start to worship him, that's when his greatest acts take place. When we worship him, his greatest acts take place. That's when God shows up. That's when the Holy Spirit is present. When we worship him, there's something about praising the name of Jesus that brings the presence of God in. When the people shouted and worshiped Jesus, then he was released to go to the cross. Amen. Jonathan, would you come this morning? I want to worship him. I want to glorify his name. Why? I want to glorify his name because he sets the captive free. He sets the captive free. I want to glorify his name because he's just. I know that when he gives me a judgment, it's going to be right. I know when he gives me a judgment, it's going to be right. Have you ever known anybody who was accused of something and they did not do it? And the evidence pointed toward them. And somebody in authority said, we know you did it. A lot of times what's happening is they're just trying to get a confession. But you knew that you didn't do it. You knew you were innocent. See, Jesus, he's always just. If you didn't do it, guess what? You don't get in trouble. The judgment doesn't come on you. That's why I worship him. I worship him because he's empowered with salvation. I worship him because not only has he saved my soul, has he saved me, that when I die, when I leave this body, that I will be present with the Lord, that I will be in heaven. But while I walk this earth, there are days when I can't save myself. There are days when I can't save my dog and I can't save my kids. One thing that will break your heart more than anything is for your kids to be hurting and you can't save them. You can't save them. Zechariah 9:9 says that Jesus is empowered with salvation. With us this morning. This morning, can we just worship him? Can we take just a few minutes this morning? Father, we exalt you. We come today and we exalt you. Will you just worship the Father with me? Father, we worship you this morning. We exalt you and praise you. Jesus, the Son the Messiah. Jesus, we worship you. We acknowledge you this morning. We worship you and praise you. We give you glory this morning. Holy Spirit, we worship you. We acknowledge that you are our help and our strength. Oh, I worship you this morning. I worship you this morning. Why are we worshiping him? Because when we worship him, something amazing happens. When we worship him, something amazing happens. Jesus, I worship you this morning. I worship you.